I am the light of the world, says the Lord. Anyone who follows me will have the light of life. All together.
Alleluia. 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 Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
Jesus came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as he usually did. He stood up to read, and they handed him the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. Unrolling the scroll, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord has been given to me, for he has anointed me. He has sent me to bring the good news to the poor, to proclaim liberty to captives, and to the blind new sight, to set the downtrodden free, and to proclaim the Lord's year of favor." He then rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the assistant and sat down. And all the eyes in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to speak to them. "This text is being fulfilled today, even as you listen." And he won the approval of all, and they were astonished by the gracious words that came from his lips. They said, "This is Joseph's son, surely." But he replied, "No doubt you will quote me the saying, 'Physician, heal yourself,' and tell me, 'We have heard all that happened in Capernaum. Do the same here in your own countryside.'" And he went on, "I tell you solemnly, no prophet is ever accepted in his own country. There were many widows in Israel, I can assure you, in Elijah's days, when the heavens remained shut for 3 years and 6 months, and a great famine raged throughout the land. But Elijah was not sent to any one of these. He was sent to a widow at Zarephath, a Sidonian town. And in the prophet Elisha's time, there were many lepers in Israel, but none of these were cured except the Syrian Naaman." When they heard this, everyone in the synagogue was enraged. They sprang to their feet and hustled him out of the town, and they took him to the brow of the hill their town was built on, intending to throw him down the cliff. But he slipped through the crowd and walked away. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please open your Bibles. We are now in Luke chapter 4. Verses 16 to 30. Luke chapter 4, verses 16 to 30. So, my dear sisters and brothers, we have finished studying the Acts of the Apostles, we finished studying the Gospel of Matthew, and today we begin studying the Gospel of Luke. We listen to it being proclaimed each day during the weekday masses. And for our reflection, we will also study it. I'd love that you study and understand the Word of God. Now, before I begin the Gospel of Luke, I want to tell you to forget everything I taught you about Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew. Why? Because the two Gospels, their orientation, we're talking about the same person. We're talking about Jesus Christ. But remember, as I keep telling you, that the Gospels are not meant to be biographies. They are not meant to tell you what Jesus did and where Jesus went. They are meant to give you the faith experience of a community. And the community of Matthew, as we've been studying, I told you, Matthew writes to a principally Jewish audience. He also, as it were, addresses some Gentiles, but his congregation is principally Jewish. They were those who were living quite close to Jerusalem. And in the case of Luke, we are looking at a completely different congregation. I've given you this example. I said, whenever I talk to people in Bandra, the language I use is quite different. When I talk to people in Malad East, the way I speak to them is quite different. My orientation, my examples, etc., everything changes. I present to them Jesus in a way that they would best understand, looking at their circumstances and looking at their lifestyle, the examples from their life. So we begin today the Gospel of Luke, and we will continue to meditate on this Gospel right till the end of this liturgical cycle, which means that we will go on till the first Sunday of Advent. Now, the author of this Gospel is Luke. But Luke, as I've told you when I taught you Acts of the Apostles, was also the author of the Acts of the Apostles. We call it Luke Acts together, both written by the same person. And St. Luke grew up from in a place called in the town of Antioch. Now, don't mix up, remember, in Acts of the Apostles, I told you, we know that there were as many as seven towns called Antioch. This is the Antioch in Syria, the Syrian Antioch where he grew up. And by profession, St. Luke was a physician. This is the reason why St. Luke is also the patron of doctors and nurses and medical staff. St. Luke was an educated man. He was a master of the Greek language. You will realize that he had very little knowledge, unfortunately, of Israel, really. You can see this in the number of mistakes, geographical mistakes he will make. But in his ability to communicate in the Greek language, he was absolutely perfect. He was also, as you will remember, a companion of St. Paul. He was a collaborator of St. Paul. He journeyed with St. Paul. And so straight away, remember, he was not one of the 12. Luke was not one of the 12 apostles. He was really a companion of St. Paul. And so he is going to be highly influenced by St. Paul. Whatever you remember I taught you about St. Paul, you will now hear it reflected literally in the thinking, in the being of St. Luke. Now, when did he write this gospel? I told you that Matthew wrote his gospel. Mark was the first gospel to be written. And St. Matthew and St. Luke borrow very largely from St. Mark. And then they add their own material. Plus, they borrow sayings from a source that we call it the Q source, which are really the sayings of Jesus. So what are the gospel writers doing? They are collecting all the material about Jesus, looking at it from their perspective, and then they put it down. Now, Matthew wrote somewhere, as I told you, between the years 70 and 80 AD. And Luke will write his gospel somewhere between the years 80 to 85 AD. It is the third gospel to be written. Now, he is writing, as I said, in Syrian Antioch, which was a very cosmopolitan, a very pluralistic society. He is addressing predominantly a Gentile community. He is not, like St. Matthew, addressing a Jewish community. So let me give you an example now of what you're going to see. In St. Luke's gospel, who do you think is going to be responsible really for the death of Jesus? And the answer is going to be largely the scribes and the Pharisees. Yeah? They were the Jews. In the Gospel of Matthew, when you read, who is primarily being blamed for the death of Jesus? Not the Pharisees and the scribes, but Pilate and the Romans. You can see the Gentiles are being blamed. Yeah? You wouldn't, if you're writing to a certain people of Bandra, you wouldn't tell them, oh, you are also, you know, criminals and murderers. You wouldn't do that. They will murder you. So remember that the orientation now, the way we look at the whole gospel is so different. But very interestingly, even though he's writing to a Gentile congregation, what you're going to see and touch in the days to come is an extremely compassionate Jesus. There is no gospel that is so compassionate, so loving, so tender. Yeah, if you remember, I always told you the easiest way to remember the Gospels, Matthew is the teaching gospel, Luke, I always said, is the feeling gospel, and Mark is the doing gospel. Feeling, why? Because of the tremendous compassion that you see Jesus is. But he's not only compassionate, but this gospel is going to be a very inclusive gospel. It's not an exclusive gospel. Matthew's gospel was Jesus has come to save the lost, the people of Israel. Luke's gospel, Jesus has come for all. In the next few days, you'll hear this word again and again. It's a three-letter word, all, but such a powerful word that comes repeatedly in the gospel of Luke. Jesus has come for all. It's a very inclusive, not an exclusive gospel. And here in this gospel, you will see that Jesus also has a preferential love for the poor, for the lost, for the sinners, for women. Yeah? This is the only gospel where in chapter 15, you will hear of the lost sheep, the lost son, the lost coin, everything that is lost, and everybody who is lost becomes the business, as it were, of Jesus in the gospel of Luke. And so you will see that there's a constant attempt to restore those who are lost back to Jesus. A very compassionate Jesus seeking those who were lost. If you feel marginalized, this gospel is for you. If you feel unloved, this gospel is for you. A lovely, loving Jesus here. But St. Luke will also present Jesus who walks the talk. He is a tough cookie in this gospel also, yeah? Not just a pushover. So right at the outset of Jesus's Galilean ministry, that's where we began. We began in chapter 4, verses 16. Why? Because the first four other chapters really deal with what is called the infancy narratives, the birth of Jesus. We're going straight to the heart of his ministry, and Jesus is bang smack in Galilee, in Nazareth. Now, he is in his hometown of Nazareth. It was this very small place. Those who go to the Holy Land, they will tell you there were hardly about 30 families or 40 families in Nazareth. And when he goes there, he publicly declares in his hometown what his pastoral mission is. Remember? He declared his manifesto, as it were, what he is here for, who he is here for. And you will hear in this gospel six incidences where Jesus, which involved Jesus on a Sabbath. Today was the first of those six incidences. It's a Sabbath service. Very interestingly, we are told that Jesus goes to the Sabbath as he usually did. Yeah? Jesus, if I may reinterpret it very loosely, never missed Sunday Mass. That's what it really means. As he usually did. He was always the Son of God, never thought of himself as one to be excused from, you know, I must confess, one day, Brother Paolo has been one of those wonderful guides in my life. And I once told him when we went on a holiday, I said, Paolo, my God, today also Mass. And sometimes I just, you know, I go to sleep in the morning. And he looked at me, I said, but Paolo, I'm on holiday. And he looked at me very sweetly and he said, but God is never on holiday. Yeah, I learned my lesson, yeah. I love the way Brother Paolo teaches me little lessons, and he does it so gently, so lovingly. I always think he should have been a formator in a seminary. Yeah, he's an excellent formator. And by the way, he's still sick, but he was on a sick bed helping out the novices today, giving them a lecture. So you can't put him down. But just the fact that Jesus never missed his Sabbath services. Now, the Sabbath service, as the Jews had it, was not like how we have it, a cyclic, cycle A, cycle B, cycle C, with different readings for different years. It was not like that. Neither was the Sabbath service conducted by somebody who was an ordained minister, a priest. You didn't need a priest. Any lay person could have led, any male lay person could have led the Sabbath service as we have it today. The reading today of today tells us in verse 23, if you look at your Bibles right now, that the people of Nazareth were already aware of the things that Jesus had worked in Capernaum, which means that Jesus had already worked miracles. He has now come to Nazareth, which is still in Galilee. And interestingly, when he comes to his hometown, they acknowledge him as Rabbi. They see already that he is a teacher. You'll see what the problem really is in a few lines from now, they acknowledge him as a rabbi. They have no problem with this. And because they see him as a rabbi, they honor him by allowing him, as it were, to read the scriptures. Yeah, on this occasion, Jesus reads the scriptures. Now, very interestingly, if you notice, they chose the book because they handed him the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. They chose the book. And then we are told that Jesus searched for the verses that he wanted. He looked till he found. So they chose the book. He chose the verses. And there was a reason why he did it. While they seem to have no problem, as it were, with the choice of text that he picked up, you can see now that they had a problem with the way in which he interpreted that text for them. It was going to be very hard for them to stomach. What text did he choose? Jesus chose a very interesting text, which is used for the Jubilee year. The word Jubilee really comes from the word Jubel. It's really a horn that they blew, a ram's horn, to indicate every 50 years that there was a Jubilee year. Remember, we too have Jubilee years, and we have extraordinary years. The last one was the extraordinary Jubilee year for mercy. And their Jubilee years were very beautiful, because in a Jubilee year, debts were forgiven. If I was stealing the land, the landlord would then hand over the land to me. You know, it was a way of making sure that everybody came back to the same level of life, you know. People were given a second chance. What a beautiful concept that is. Everybody in this world was given a second chance in the Jubilee year. Everybody was given a chance to come back to a sense of fairness. And Jesus picks that text. He wants everybody to get a second chance, everybody to be raised back again to a level of fairness, not one greater and one lesser. And in that context, he announces, as he says, good news. He says, I'm announcing good news for the poor, release for the captives, sight to the blind, freedom to those who are in prison and those who are oppressed. Clearly, you can see St. Luke is giving us what kind of mandate Jesus has, what kind of vision Jesus has. You're clearly seeing who Jesus has come for in the Gospel of Luke, yeah? Straight at the beginning. Now, for Jesus, the good news is not for the metaphorically poor. Earlier, when they spoke of the poor, it really meant metaphorically the people of Israel. Jesus is not saying, I'm here for some, you know, some vague group. No, he's very specific. He says, I have come for the economically poor. That's why I said, this is a gospel where Jesus loves the poor. He's come for the socially marginalized. He's come for those who are physically unfortunate. He's come for all those who are pushed to the corners of society. And Jesus now makes his manifesto so clear. He launches his mission in the synagogue in his own hometown. Now, we therefore come to the whole problematic of today's gospel. And that you see in verse 22. Because suddenly, Jesus seems to get a little bit annoyed. Yeah? Why? So look at your Bible now, and you will see verse 22, which read, all spoke well of him, and they were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. Yet, they follow this by saying, hey, but isn't this Joseph's son? Isn't this the carpenter's son? We know this guy. We know this guy. And immediately Jesus goes into some kind of a confrontational mode with them. So why this sudden switch from such great hospitality to so much of hostility? Why did this switch really happen? And as I've often told you, the issue is when we translate the text from Greek to English. The text should have really translated as this. All spoke well of him, yet were astonished at the words of salvation, not just any words, the words of salvation that came from his mouth. Because he was just not the son of Joseph, he is the son of God. You see, this is where the problem was. Hey, you're working miracles? Great, we enjoy your miracles. We heard of your great miracles in Capernaum. Wonderful, Jesus. Do the same here. But when he starts talking about salvation, oh, you know, it is like me telling you, everything that's nice and then saying, okay, I've got to deal with all the sinners now in our congregation. And you're saying, okay, Father Warner, that's where you stop. Yeah, all the other teachings are fine. About going to heaven, that's our business. Don't tell us what to do. We know what we are supposed to do. And Jesus here is come very clearly as the Son of God to proclaim salvation. You see, this is the problem with a lot of people. We don't want the bitter pill. I always like St. Paul, because St. Paul was a straight-talking, no-nonsense man. Yeah? As I always say, St. Paul did not suffer fools very easily. And I must say, I take comfort in the fact that I don't suffer fools also very easily. And St. Paul very clearly said in his writings, he said, we have begun to pander to people, to congregations with itchy ears. And they seek preachers who speak to their itchy ears. St. Luke, as I said, is not going to be an easy pushover. At the beginning of Jesus' ministry, Luke now has laid out very clearly the mission of Jesus, his preferential option for the poor, and interestingly, his preferential option for the Gentiles. The Spirit of the Lord has been given to him not only for the Jews, but for everybody else. Now, imagine me saying this, because I like to rile you up a bit in order to get you your full attention. If you really want to know why the people in that synagogue so angry with Jesus, it's like me saying, okay, all the online people, from tomorrow onwards, I want to tell you that my focus of my love and affection is going to be for all those who are non-Christians only. How are you going to take it? How are you going to take it? Yeah? What? Father Warner? Nothing for us? For them? Ah, now that priest, you know, they don't bother about us. Oh, all the outsiders and these other people of other religions and all. Ah, they are. You see, that's the way the Jews spoke of Jesus. They were upset because Jesus has come for all. And look at Jesus. Instead of calming his congregation, he has a habit of really instigating them a bit. Why do I say this? Look at the examples he gave them. Yeah? He says, I've come for all, I've come for the poor, I've come for the lost, I've come for the Gentiles. And then he gives them two examples, one which is found in 1 Kings chapter 17 and the other in 2 Kings chapter 5. The examples of Elijah and Elisha. Elijah the prophet was sent to no home in Israel, says Jesus. He was not sent to any home in Israel, not to any of the Christians. But he was sent to a foreigner, an enemy, a widow, a Sidonian widow in the town of Zarephath. And then, as it were, Jesus gives him the second example. And he says, look at Elisha. There were many lepers in Israel. Who was Elisha sent to? He was sent to Naaman the Syrian, the general of an enemy. I don't know how you as a congregation would take me saying something similar. I have not come for you anymore. I have come for so-and-so person in that building and that one in the other community and that one from another religion. And you can see why they were so riled up. Because Jesus in the Gospel of Luke is saying, I have come for all. Stop making yourselves the exclusive objectivity of my love and affection. As we do sometimes. Jesus is ours. Like we want to lock him up in a box and never share him with others. But the whole key purpose of a Christian is evangelization. Which is what? To take the message of Jesus to others. I have often said this and I'll say it again. Our churches today are saving the saved. Meaning to say, we are very good at ministering to the regular people who come to church. What about those who are lost? What about those on the fringes? What about those who are marginalized? And the Jesus in the Gospel of Luke is going to do the same. You know, often God's news is not the good news we want to hear. It's not the good news we want to hear. And the Gospel of Luke begins with a bang, where Jesus says, I have come for all. For women, for children, for the lost, for the Gentiles, for the marginalized. Yes, also for you. But don't lock me in a box, because I need to be shared with everybody. What was the reaction of the people? His own people. His own people. Remember, when you're stoned, you're never stoned by outsiders. You're usually stoned by your own. What was the reaction of his own people? They pushed him out of the synagogue, took the Son of God to a cliff, wanting to kill him. And guess what? We are only in chapter 4, and they already want to kill Jesus.